لیکن بہت شکریہ ڈاکٹر رفیق مصطفیٰ شاہ صاحب، آپ نے یہ عزت بخشی، اتنے معزز شخصیات کے ساتھ مجھ جیسے ناچیز کو بھی شامل کیا، اور ماشاءاللہ جنڈر امبیلنس کا یہ حال ہے، ایک مظلوم خاتون کو آپ نے ہم ظالم مردوں کے ساتھ بٹھا دیا، یار ویسے وہ بھی کونے پہ، میں نے کہا بھی جب میں آیا کہ یار آپ ادھر بیٹھے ہیں، بیچ میں بیٹھے ہیں، بٹ رفیق مصطفیٰ شاہ، یو اینڈ یور میچو میسکولینٹی، میل ڈومینیشن، ہیں، اینڈ لرن فرام یور ڈیئر بلوڈ فادر، ہو واز سچ اے جینڈر کے بالکل ٹرانسینڈ ہو کر وہ دیکھا کرتے تھے، بٹ ماشاء اللہ what a galaxy of fine individuals you have assembled here on the stage, such eminent persons, and here from all possible major disciplines, from the judiciary to media to the foreign office to the air force to academia to business, corporate sector, millionaires of money and millionaires of ideas. Fantastic. Their presence here is a really apt tribute to this extraordinary gentleman we have gathered together to honor today, Sayyid Ghulam Mustafa Shah. You know, it was said about him more than once in the preceding minutes about him conducting an interview. One of the most vivid memories I associate with Mustafa Shah Sahib is that every meeting of mine with him was an interview. He was always interviewing me like he would most people, but not interviewing a person from a condescending or a judgmental point of view, but really finding out about that person and also making that person conscious of what that person was who was being interviewed, but equally without in any way being immodest, being making that person conscious of what a remarkable gentleman one had the privilege of meeting. And I have the privilege of knowing him in several dimensions. First of all, my late father, Ahmed Abdul Jabbar, who was a former senior official of the government of Pakistan, and because of his literary pursuits, happened to know him. And I knew of this figure called Sayyid Ghulam Mustafa Shah. But perhaps on a more frequent level, and even more purposeful level, when I happened to cast my eyes on the woman with whom I would lead my life, Shabnam, it turned out that her parents were very close friends of Sayyid Ghulam Mustafa Shah. And one of the interviews that I had to be subjected to before I could get clearance to advance my conspiracy about matrimony was clearance from Ghulam Mustafa Shah. So he gave a no objection certificate because he thought ye chal jayega bachcha mane dekhbhal kar lega Rashid Ahmed ki beti ka. So one had very great respect for him ki unhone shayad misjudgment ki hai, because after all he was a human being and he was capable of error. To mere case mein to misjudgment kar di, but for me it was a very benign misjudgment. But then even before we met up in the political realm, purely in the social, cultural and educational realm, as a development practitioner or as a writer, one interacted with him. And then one had the honor of sharing with him the first cabinet of Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto, when he joined about 3.5 months after we were sworn in December 1988, and he joined us in March as the Federal Minister of Education. And both the portfolios that I held as a very humble Minister of State for Information and Broadcasting and then Science and Technology brought me into frequent contact with him. And the contacts were both mutually supportive, but also sometimes very sharp and not necessarily in harmony with each other's views. But it was so marvelous to contest intellectually or politically any of his views, because I always owed him a great debt. When I was sitting out for election as a technocrat to the Senate of Pakistan in non-party based elections from a non-political background, I needed support from people who I had no knowledge of, MPAs from rural center, from urban center. And I want to acknowledge the debt I owe to Sayyid Ghulam Mustafa Shah, who very graciously used his stature and his influence to mislead some innocent MPAs into casting their vote for me. And I would not have been elected without his support. So thank you, Ghulam Mustafa Shah Saab, for your very valuable support. And in the cabinet that we shared together, it is mistakenly assumed, because our tenure was cut short arbitrarily by President Ghulam Issa Khan, that we were a clueless government. We didn't know what we should be doing. We had for the first time a government in Punjab which was hostile to the federal government. It had never happened before in Pakistan's history. But the record needs to be corrected. Because take the field of education alone. Thousands of primary schools were set up during the tenure of Ghulam Mustafa Shah Saab as Federal Education Minister. Tens of thousands of children who would not otherwise have had access to primary or secondary schools were given that access. And particularly girls and women who went on to become very valuable parts of this nation. As also the scholarship program. As a Minister of State for Science and Technology, I had responsibility for continuing the very fine program initiated by Dr. Mehbubul Haq. And Ghulam Mustafa Shah Saab ensured that every scholarship given under that program was given on the basis of merit. We together withstood enormous partisan pressure. There was tremendous pressure from within the party, some sections of the party, to overlook some shortcomings of some candidates. But he stood firm. And the reason he stood firm was his qualities of character, integrity, unshakable by the fact that Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto was Prime Minister. And these values reflected what kind of a gentleman he was. He was candid to the point of being almost harsh. Him as a custodian of the servants of Sindh society. I see him humbly, from my part, not just as a servant of Sindh. Yes, Sindh deserves to be looked after. But he was really a custodian of the Indus Valley civilization. He was not narrow and parochial, confined to Sindh only, or to, as we say, some of us, characters like me who have encroached upon this land, have migrated from another part of South Asia and settled here, and we love Sindh as much as I suppose anyone else. We fell in love with the soil and the soul of Sindh. But I don't think that Shah Saab was parochial. He was certainly very fierce and intense about being Sindhi. But his Sindhiness was not a narrow-minded Sindhiness. It was an inclusive, pluralist, humanist ethos that was willing to embrace diversity. What greater proof that he would look upon people purely on the basis of their individual merit, not on the basis of whether they were Punjabis or Baloch or Pashtun. And therefore that, I think, was a great contribution. Particularly at a time when Sindh was beset with incredible demographic change, unprecedented in Sindh's history. Out of the 10 million refugees who migrated, several million settled in Sindh. The way Sindh welcomed them with open hearts and open doors, no other part of Pakistan did that. And yet, it was being disruptive to the traditional ethos and ethics and values, but also the sheer quality of life of Sindh, the tranquility of Sindh, and in a way the benevolent insulation of Sindh, not isolation, but the insulation of Sindh. It was all being disrupted. And at that time, to be the custodian of values that really belong to the Indus Valley civilization, I think he rendered a great service. My second and last point is going to be, I see him as a symbol of how an individual possessed of extraordinary intellect was dealing with the challenge of the new nation state and the historicity and the legacy of time. The nation state all over the world is a very rapacious, aggressive entity. In its ugliest form, it can be India, which divided up Hyderabad, Deccan, from where my father came, and partitioned it off into Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, destroyed the synergy of Hyderabad, Deccan, under the ambition of building a new nation state. Similarly, in Pakistan, a new nation state that had never existed in history before, coming in composed of Sindh, Balochistan, Punjab, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, NWFP, and of course East Pakistan. How is this nation state going to become real and credible? Some part of that ethos had to trample upon the historic identity of those constituent parts, and that brought us that curse of the one unit. And Shah Sahib's determination to preserve the ethos and the values of Sindh, I think, signified this battle that will continue for some time. How does the nation state reconcile with the beauty, the legacy, the sacredness of time that we inherit and the values that we all cherish? So may you be happy in heaven, Shah Sahib.